Hi, how you doing, mate? You all right?
Hello, mate. How you doing?
I'm good. I'm not too bad, mate. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you fine.
Listen, mate, thanks very much for jumping on the podcast with us. I appreciate it.
That's cool, man. No problem.
Not brilliant, obviously. So we just wanted to get you on to obviously chat about obviously Bellator Dublin.
Oh my God,
it's
out now.
I know, that's it. That was the thing. Obviously, Cal was scheduled to fight James Gallagher. Obviously, he lost that fight the first time. In terms of the fight, didn't happen due to obviously the issues with the scan. Again, out with his hands, and then for it to happen again, how gutting was that for Cal?
Oh yeah, it is. I mean, it's Carl's only job as well, you know. So it's like, so when you're waiting to get paid as well, like, it's kind of it's a bit hard. Then he's still getting some money off them, but obviously, there's problems with like he sold loads of tickets over there as well. It's quite a problem for everybody. But he sold loads of tickets, and now he's going to go around handing every ticket back, and he's obviously like, booked flights for his family and hotels and stuff, which he's already paid for. So he kind of loses all that as well. So it's not ideal, but. By the sounds of it, I still think that possibly might be happening. It might just be obviously when James is healed up now.
That's the side I guess a lot of people don't see when they see a fight's off. It's the effects on like the Cal side. It's financial, because he'll obviously get, I'm assuming he'll get show money, but then
he's getting show money still.
And I spoke to Cal through Instagram and stuff, and he seemed obviously gutted, especially with the fact so many tickets sold and people going over there. That's I guess a side people don't actually see.
Yeah, I think he just feels like everybody's going to think he's let them down, you know, because but because that's what he's bothered about. But I told him, I said, it's one of them things, and nobody's going to like be disliking you for it. It's just they'll be a bit annoyed by the situation, maybe, but nobody kind of blames Carl for it, do they? It happens. And obviously, this fight is just not meant to be at the minute, is it?
I know it's kind of turning into the Khabib Tony of Bellator, isn't it?
Exactly the same, yeah.
The other thing as well, it was an undisclosed injury. I'm assuming you haven't heard anything, or
we got told broken foot,
right?
But then James Gallagher on his Instagram, he said he'd hurt his back, so I'm not too sure. So I'm assuming I'll go with what James Gallagher's saying. I'm assuming he's got a bad back. I'm going with that. He's got a bad back.
I guess you can only take him at his word. Was there any actual, did Bellator make any effort or any attempts to try and match Cal last minute? Was there any?
Not at all. That's why we're, I'm a little bit annoyed by that. I don't see why they wouldn't have just, because like Bellator can get a guy, not even a last minute guy, who's going to lie down. They can get a good guy in like 3 weeks' notice, can't they? And but there was nothing that just says they weren't going to rematch it.
It was strange to me as well, because obviously when the fight was scheduled the first time, obviously Cal had his issues with scans and stuff. But James get matched, so that's where I found it a bit strange.
I don't really understand the thinking in that. And I know obviously James Gallagher's the hometown fighter, but Carl still sold quite a few tickets, like massive, like a ridiculous amount for an away fighter where everybody's going to get an aeroplane over. He sold a lot of tickets. So I can't really understand it, to be honest. I'm not sure what the thinking behind it is or what the logic. And I know the main event they've got now, the two girls, and I know they're really, really good, but I don't think they really should be main event, maybe. I'm not sure.
It was definitely a strange one for me. The only thing I could sort of come to the conclusion is that obviously they'll do anything they can to keep James on the card, which I understand completely, obviously, with him, his popularity and it being over in Ireland. But I thought they would maybe try and get Cal a fight, and like, I guess as well, it's to keep Cal active, because he's put a lot of time in recently, and he's not probably having as many fights as he would like, I'm assuming.
No, like I say, he's full time fighter now as well, so obviously not getting paid properly. And I know people think like you get a decent lumber when you fight, but if you haven't fought for like a year and a half, and then like even I know he's getting his show money still, but like most of that is gone before you even get it, isn't it?
It's definitely unless you're at that high Conor McGregor crazy level, it's not something you get into for financial gain anyway.
No, definitely you just do because you love doing it. But I don't understand why they didn't just find Carl a replacement and just maybe he's not having main event, which would have been fine.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm not too sure, you know, I don't know. There's obviously some, like, political reason why they've done that, but I can't really understand why they haven't. Like I say, he sold, like, 160 tickets.
Yeah.
Which, that's just him out of his hand, going around handing them out, you know, like, and I'm sure there's been a lot more through the website and stuff, you know, which is quite a few for a runaway fighter.
And obviously the other thing we touched on at the start is Ryan Scope was scheduled to fight. What's the situation with Ryan there?
I think he broke his hand. Well, he did break his hand. He's still trying to train. He's still planned on fighting. And then he's still training as if he was fighting. And then just got to the point where he's making it worse and he couldn't hit pads. He couldn't spar. So he kind of he made the decision himself to pull out from that. But Ryan is still with a few injuries over the years. I think it's because he's trained from so young as well, you know. He's a massive talent, Ryan. It's just a bit unfortunate with some things that happen.
It's not just that. I mean, sometimes Bellator can be accused of some interesting matchmaking, to say the least. But if you look at Ryan's journey in Bellator so far, Ryan has not had an easy ride in the promotion. He's fought nothing but top level guys since he came in.
Yeah, I think. I thought, I know it's different when you're watching it, and I know it was close, but I thought Ryan kind of pinched the Pitbull fight. I think it was that close. I'm not whinging about the decision, you know what I mean? But I did score it as Ryan had won. I think he started slow, but then I think he got the next two rounds. But obviously it wasn't to be that as well, so that was a bit harsh. And the Quayle fight, I just think, obviously, the Ryan score, that I get to say, he didn't really turn up for that one either.
With regards to the Patrici fight, I was at the event, so I watched it cage side, and I didn't think Ryan had won initially, but then I rewatched the fight.
Yeah.
And it was when I rewatched that I thought, I'd obviously missed some stuff in the fight. It's a wee bit different when you're watching it with the crowd and stuff like that. Because I think I was sitting next to Jake and... And then I'd spoke to Jake about it, and then I'd spoke to him after I'd rewatched it, and I thought no, my initial thoughts were wrong, but
it is hard from the corner. Like I remember at the time scoring it to Ryan, but maybe there was a bit of emotion involved in that, but when I watched it back, I thought, like I say, you kind of whinge about it. It was a close fight. It's not like the robbery of the century, was it? It was just a close fight, and it got scored against us, unfortunately. So sometimes you get them, sometimes you don't, like that, isn't it?
Oh, well, that's it. And I guess out with you're obviously a busy man as well, Andrew. You're obviously, your gym's really producing some outstanding fighters.
Oh, we're doing good now. The guys are getting about now. We're fighting on a decent level as well.
So obviously Perry Goodwin as well. He seems to has he found his new home down at Featherweight now?
Perry is just like the hardest work you've ever met in your life, you know.
Yeah, and that guy is not in a boring fight either.
No, he's just like my opinion of Perry before, for his fight wise, it was kind of like, I would have thought, he's maybe going to win as many as he's going to lose, but he's always going to be in fight of the night. But now I'm just thinking he's just going to walk through, but he's still going to be in fight of the night, but he's going to blow through everybody now.
So do you think that experience of fighting the level of guys he's fought and the sort of fights he's had at the higher weight classes, do you think that's all prepared him to get down to featherweight and sort of really launch his career from here?
Perry had his first pro fight and he used to train in a garage with his dad. he just used to turn up with his dad, and we used to see him on local shows, and he just turned up with his dad, right? And he'd just be like getting in everybody's face, just everybody. He seemed like an awful person. But then he kind of came to my gym, and he just wins. He's like the nicest person ever, you know. And he's like a soldier, you know. If I thought something was a good idea for his fight, he would do it without any question or without thinking, oh, well, what if he does this or anything? He's got that much faith in what his coaches are telling him that's right. Whereas everybody else, they know if somebody, if you shout it, throw a combo now, they might be a bit hesitant to do it. Yeah. Perry just does it as and when, you know. He's a great person to train, and he's a proper character in the gym as well, and he is the hardest worker I've ever met. He's not the most gifted at all, but he's so absolutely nails, you know, as well.
Yeah.
Just the toughest man ever. And he likes to say, who doesn't like watching him fight?
Well, that's it. It's, I mean, what more can you ask for? He's an extremely exciting fighter, and obviously it's good to see that he's found that. He's sort of found his home down at featherweight. And yeah. With regards to yourself, obviously, I'm assuming you've been getting the itch for a while to get back in there and finally butt the bullet and decided to go for it.
Yeah, well, I went to fight in Australia for ACB. Mm-hmm. Must be not going on a year and a half now. Mm-hmm. My last training session, I got a really bad concussion. Mm-hmm. Anyway, but it's probably another full podcast, that story. I got a really bad concussion anyway, and the doctors in this country are pretty appalling on it, you know. They just want you to go and sit in a dark room till it clears up. So it took us a long time, to get better and my eyes to get fixed and my vestibular system. But I had to kind of, do it all myself, the research for it, and I was emailing doctors in America, and they were, they would send us papers and journals to read, and I would go through them and then try and learn what the words meant, and then eventually I kind of got fixed and then I'm still back training probably now as well.
So have you got a sort of, what's your sort of schedule? Is there a sort of time you're aiming to get back?
They're sometimes not the best to deal with Bellator, you know. Promotions, you know. Do you know if they want something from you, they're fast on the phone to you, but as soon as you just ask them a question, you know, you just don't really get much back. Like when Ryan pulled out, and so obviously I was the first to know Ryan was pulling out, and then he messaged them to see he's pulled out, and then I messaged pretty much straight afterwards, said I would fight Redmond, and then I didn't get a reply. So then I kind of I went on Twitter and I just, somebody put up, Jake Smith put a post on about Ryan pulling out. So I commented underneath that, just saying, I've just messaged Jude and said I would fight Redmond. And then I got a few shares and people commented stuff. And then I still never heard anything. So I messaged again on Twitter and said, message him again. I still never heard anything. And I think it was the next day, I kind of eventually got a reply saying, it's gone. So I would have took that one, but that didn't happen, obviously.
So it's just really a case of waiting then, and waiting and being ready when that call does come.
Yeah, well, they said they did give us a month, but they haven't given us anything other than that. No location or no date or any fighter. So I'm not too sure, but it's fine. And, you know, it's just normal, isn't it, really?
That's it. And it's not like you're sitting about doing nothing anyway, because not only are you obviously head coach for your own gym, obviously you're back in, you're fighting now, running a promotion as well. I believe the next one's in April. So how have you found that? Matching fights, dealing with fighters for that side of things, as well as juggling the gym and getting your own training in. You're a busy man.
I definitely think I'm busy. I don't really get to sit down much, and I've got three kids as well, which is, I don't know. It doesn't really feel like work anymore, because I like all of us.
Aye.
So I would love to, I definitely don't stop, but this is stuff coaching and training. I was doing it for free before people wanted to pay us, and I was happy to do that, you know. So I can't really grumble, and I can't really whinge about being busy. Matching for the show, can definitely get a bit stressful sometimes. But it goes well, you know. I don't know. I've got a great life, really, so I can't really complain. I can't really be stressed about it, can I?
Nah, well, that's it. So we'll just finish on this one. So you're saying there, you're doing all that stuff, but do you feel fortunate getting to do all that for a living? Obviously, when you see people going out to their 95s and stuff like that, but you get to go and do what you love then.
I've done that as well, you know. Worked in factories and stuff, doing shifts. And but if when I was a kid, say if I was a 12-year-old kid, and somebody offered me the life I've got now, I wouldn't have believed them, and I would have snapped the hands off for it. So you can't grumble, can you?
Well, that's it. And well, listen again.
So how about you? How about you? What about your life? How do you feel about yours?
Mine's as good. I feel quite fortunate as well. I don't fight, but I love fighting, and I get to come on to podcasts, and I get to interview fighters, and I get to do this stuff. This is all.
You meet some cool people as well, don't you? And I bet you get some cool stories as well.
Well, that's it. It's enjoyable. Hopefully the sport continues to grow in this country. That's the main thing that it's a shared thing in the MMA community. Everybody wants to see the sport continue to grow and just make that step to the main mainstream level. Obviously, it has its peaks and then it drops a wee bit. But
I mean, we just need like more, because a lot of people over here they're just like UFC fans. You know, the UFC can sell somewhere else, but every other show, it's a case of it's friends of the fighters buy the tickets, isn't it?
Well,
and that's what's kind of holding them back a little bit. Whereas you go to other countries and people just want to come and watch the MMA, don't they?
Well, see, one of the things I got a wee bit lucky with is I get to go to a lot of regional shows, but I always intentionally, I try and get one or two of my friends to come with me. Guys, because I'm just said, if you like watching a UFC and stuff like that, just come to a regional show. It feels different when you can hear the impact. You can just the smells, the atmosphere. Exactly. I was like, go to regional shows. That'll make you a bigger fan than you are at the moment. And obviously there's high quality fights out there everywhere. It's not just the UFC, but people just, I think that's the main thing. Watch all promotions. If you enjoy fighting, why not watch the other promotions? Yeah. And you know,
Scotland's
what I mean?
Scotland's a very hard one to break into, isn't it, as well?
I mean, don't get me wrong, I've been banging the drums for years about getting shows here. I mean, there's obviously been mistakes, but
the Scots people, like I fought on ACB in, I think it was Glasgow, and it was a great card. You know, like they obviously must have spent a lot of money paying some of the wages for the people, and it was absolutely dead. It's just hard to get, like I say, unless it's like fighters, friends selling tickets, it's just very hard to get any bums on seats in Scotland, isn't it? It's the same where I live, but it's very hard.
But I mean, it's certainly changing. I think ACB made some big mistakes made on where they put the show, when they put the show, and how they promoted the show. I think they could have done a better job. But it's one of the ones. I think it's. I mean, who doesn't like watching good fights?
I don't know.
It's like that old quote: if somebody's playing football in one corner, hockey in the other corner, another sport in one, and there's a fight in the other corner, everybody goes to the fight.
You're right.
I will catch on in this country. I think what we need is we need that superstar guy for each region. That's what you need. That's it. But. Anyway, we'll let you go on that one, mate. Obviously, I appreciate you coming on the Higher Level podcast. And obviously, when you get some fight news, let us know.
I will do, mate. Thank you very much for having us on as well.
No problem at all, mate. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye. Bye.